Thanks, Andy. Couldn't even see your hands moving. So, The Wizard of Oz, a story that we're all familiar with, mainly in this country because of the movie that was made in 1939, but it was from a series of books by Frank Baum called The Wizard of Oz, and they came from stories he made up to tell his children when they were little. The story has many what we would call archetypal images. It's a hero's tale, and it's about a metaphysical hero's journey about discovering this true self. And many of us have watched this film and read the stories over the years without really making that connection, because most of us in our culture, we haven't been taught to think symbolically. We haven't been taught to look for the hidden meaning in things. So the story begins in Kansas. Kansas is the consciousness that represents home, the essence of the self. This part of the film is filmed in, it's often called black and white. It's really not. It's sepia tone. It has kind of a brownish tint to it. It represents comfort and safety, but it's kind of lifeless. There's no color. Dorothy, who represents you and I, has a support system there, but she's an orphan. She lives with her aunt and uncle and three questionable characters. It's a non-traditional family, and in that time, that meant that not all is right. There's something not quite right about things. All of the characters and aspects in her life are present here. We see all the signs of what the future will be. There is a foreshadowing of her hero's journey here, just as there always is in the lives that are lived up to the beginning of that journey. But the bad choices she makes here turn her life bleak and gray until things begin to spin out of control. We are all on a journey home. The archetypal idea of the source is inside of all of us. Over the Rainbow sets the scene in consciousness for a journey, for a quest. Dorothy looks to the future for a better life experience. She embarks on her hero's journey. The cyclone appears. Dorothy and Toto are swept up into a vortex. A vortex is an energy system that's represented by a spiral. You're drawn in and swept away. A time in life of rapid changes, it can seem like a storm. The storms of our lives often lift us out of where we have been and put us into a new place. The storm seems like your enemy, but it has the purpose of lifting you into a higher and better place. So Dorothy and Toto, they land in Oz, a new and most unusual place. It's an imaginary, dreamlike place where all the people and things in life that are somehow recognizable but somehow different. The sepia tone transforms to color. Okay. We meet the Munchkins. There they are.
She fell from the sky. She fell very far. And Kansas, she says, is the name of the star.
Kansas, she says, is the name of the star.
So the Munchkins represent hidden thoughts of the dream world. Beauty not fully revealed. They represent hidden and repressed energies within each of us, the lost childhood that could have been. And also in this point, we meet some witches from the north. We discover there are at least four from the north, south, east, and west, each representing an area of power. This is a very old idea in archetypal understanding. The house, which is from the old consciousness, lands on the Wicked Witch of the East, for which the Munchkins are very grateful. It's a sign of the unintended consequences of change.
We thank you very sweetly for doing it so neatly.
You've killed us so completely that we thank you very sweetly.
Let the joyous news be spread. The wicked old witch at last is dead.
So the ruby slippers happen to come onto Dorothy's feet, representing the inner spark of power. She doesn't quite understand what they are, but she knows there's something going on here. Now the Wicked Witch of the West, the sister of the unfortunate being under the house, wants those slippers. But as she reaches for them, sparks shoot out. She can't get to the center of power because the slippers represent an inner power that outside forces can't access. It's the power that you and I have to change our lives if only we would recognize it. And the Wicked Witch has no power in the presence of this inner power. There's no power of an external force that can overcome an intrinsic power of good. Dorothy has the power right now, but doesn't know how to use it. And she is like all of us. Then we meet Glenda, the Good Witch of the North. She's kind of a Zen master, right? Shows up in a pink bubble representing a maternal figure. The bubble represents a womb from which she emerges. Essentially, she doesn't really do anything but give encouragement and the occasional suggestions. She's not a zap it, make it happen kind of witch. She's more of a person you meet. The hero will meet people along the journey that are all teachers, but you have to figure out what kind of teacher they are. So the suggestion she gives is you ought to go see the wizard, the wonderful Wizard of Oz. He's a wizard because of the wonderful things he does. See, he's got the power. She represents the higher consciousness in us directing us on our journey, directing us toward home. And the yellow brick road is the path to be taken.
Follow the yellow brick road.
So the yellow brick road begins right at the center point. It begins right where she is. She's right there at the beginning of it, as we always are. It represents the flow of life, or the Tao. It is always to be followed. It's from the intuitive self. The yellow brick road leads to the Emerald City, but there are a few trials along the way. It's a true heroic tale. So like any hero on a journey, Dorothy will need some friends, and she finds some friends. So she has a goal and is on a pathway, and she happens upon some people that can help her or not help her. And the first friend is the Scarecrow.
I could while away the hours, confirm with the flowers, consult with the rain. And my head, I'd be scratching while my thoughts were busy hatching if I only had a brain. I'd unravel every riddle for any...
The Scarecrow is wisdom disguised as intellectual confusion. He's running our video today, in fact. He can't even scare a crow. He's not very good at his job, right? He's kind of stuck in confusion. He says inappropriate things at inappropriate times. Dorothy has to pull him down off a hook. He's stuck in his confusion. He represents how thinking can be a guide to your spirit and what happens in your life. So then she meets a second friend, the Tin Man.
When a man's an empty kettle,
He should be on his mettle, and yet I'm torn apart. Just because I'm presuming that I could be kinda human if I only had a heart.
So the Tin Man is love disguised as a sense of being heartless, feelings without love. He rusts when he cries. He's stuck in an emotional pattern that he can't find his way out of. Poor John. I was wondering what you would do if you had an itch. So that's the second of her friends. And the third is the Cowardly Lion, my favorite. The third
and
is the character.
Can't believe me, Missy, when you're born to be a sissy without the feminine vibe. But I could show my prowess, be a lion, not a mouse, if I only had the nerve. I'm afraid there's no denying I'm just a dandelion, a fate I don't deserve.
So the Cowardly Lion is courage disguised as wishful thinking. He surges after Toto, and he's crushed when Dorothy slaps him on the nose. His real self is shown when his lack of courage is touched. So, here we have the team. We have Dorothy, Toto, and her team, someone without any brains, someone without any heart, and a coward. Ever been there? Now, of course, like all metaphorical stories, they don't represent individuals, they represent aspects of the self. And quite often when you have a goal or something, you're moving forward in terms of your management team, and this is who you've got. So, next track. So there's danger present. The team goes through blocks in consciousness in the apple trees where they mistake the nature of the forest, and in the poppy field where they go to sleep. You ever had your faculties go to sleep on you? But then they finally, the goal is in sight, the Emerald City, with a little help from Glinda in melting the snow, or actually providing the snow, excuse me. And they go beyond the gate or the facade of Emerald City, where they are cleaned and buffed and refreshed. That was, I think we played that already, didn't we? He's doing this in the back. Okay, so we're out of the woods. They meet the wizard, who they're very afraid of. I mean, this is an authority figure who has been put forth by others as the supreme authority of the land, and here they come to ask for a favor of some kind. And they ask for their desires. But the wizard's a fake. He sends them on a quest, hoping that they will fail. But see, on the hero's journey, once you reach the initial goal, you're just beginning. There is always then the quest. You notice, if you remember, like in Indiana Jones, he'll find the cave, but then you got to go through the cave, and that's where the snakes are. So he sends them off to get rid of them, in a sense, but really what he's doing is he's providing them with a vehicle to realize their own power. He says, bring me the broomstick of the Wicked Witch of the West, who is an even more terrifying figure to them than he is. They plan what to do next, how to overcome their fear. They go deep into anguish and fear, which is represented by the depth of the forest and the darkness of the castle. Lions and tigers and bears Oh my. I do believe in spooks. I do believe in spooks. Right? As they talk themselves into their fear as they go toward the goal. They confront the witch finally, and the witch represents negativity. So she decides, as negativity often will do, and again, this represents something from within ourselves, and what negativity can do is cancel goodness. So the first thing she attacks is wisdom. She takes her broom and torches the scarecrow. Now Dorothy picks up a pail of water, which represents purification, to save the scarecrow. Interesting that there happened to be a bucket of water sitting there at that moment. But there always is. Whatever you need is always there. The water dissolves the threat of the witch. What a world, what a world. I'm melting.
Witch, old witch, the wicked witch. Hail, hail, the wicked witch is dead. Hail, hail, the witch is dead. Witch, old witch, the wicked witch. Hail, hail, the wicked witch is dead. Run, witch, up and go. Up and go below your home. And up and up and sing. And ring about the wind from the very low.
So they had thought that when the witch died, the soldiers would be their threat, but the soldiers were the energy waiting to be released. They were the energy seeking freedom from the control of negativity. And the soldiers become their allies. So now the last part of the journey is you have to go home. So the wizard, they go back to the wizard again. And now they figure out that he really is a fake. Pay no attention to the man behind the curtain. The big scary edifice that they first see, it turns out to be projection. Projection that came from fear. But the wizard has some wisdom. So what he does is, in order to help the faculties, the friends, affirm their own strengths, he gives them representations of their true attributes. The scarecrow gets a diploma, because every smart person has a diploma. The tin man gets a clock that ticks like a heart. The lion gets a medal, because what better way to affirm courage than with a medal? The military does that all the time, right? And what was revealed by this, as they affirm it for themselves, was what was already within them, but they needed to have some external authority affirm them in order for them to believe it about themselves. Because really, the wizard didn't give them anything they didn't already have. Think about that next time you look at the diploma on your wall. But Dorothy wants to go home. She wants to return to Kansas. She wants to return to a sense of her true self. Although there's a couple of problems with that. One is the wizard can't do that for her. The other is you can't go back and have things be the way they were. Glenda's there, but she can only help so much. She's kind of a ditherer. But she does remind Dorothy of her own inner power, about the ruby slippers, which represent that inner power. So sometimes we must never depend on external sources for our power, but external sources can provide us with direction inward. And that's what happens now. Dorothy begins to realize through these teachers that the power was within her all along. And she says goodbye to each one, the lion, the tin man, and the scarecrow. And then she really does discover that the wizard can't take her home to Kansas when Toto wisely jumps out of that basket. And she has to go get him, Toto being that sense of the instinctive self. And she realizes only she can do that, and she must do it by clicking her heels together 3 times. Everybody do that. Just click your heels together 3 times. Click, click, click. They say there's no place like home. There's no place like home. There's no place like home. Home is the awareness of your own self. We would call it the awareness of the presence of spirit, practicing the presence. And Dorothy gets to go home, but it's different. The familiar is now different somehow. She's had a transformation in consciousness as a result of this journey. She sees things in a new way. She learns that you already possess the attributes you seek most passionately. She no longer needs to leave to go over the rainbow. So to conclude the talk, I'm going to invite you all to stand up. And we're going to sing along with Dorothy as she goes over the rainbow. As we just give us a second to set up the video. And I will silence my mic.
Thank you.